Hallelujah. We're still here, folks. Amen. We'll be here till he comes to get us. If I could speed it up, I would. But there's not a whole lot I can do about that. Would you turn to the book of Psalm with me tonight, please? Chapter number 24. 24th Psalm. Get that in one hand, Psalm 68 in the other. Twenty-fourth Psalm, verse number 7. Psalm chapter number 24, and verse number 7. The Word of God says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." Who is this King of glory? The Lord Jehovah, strong and mighty. The Lord Jehovah, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Once again, who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. Selah. That is an announcement of what took place after he visibly left sight of the earth. In the 68th Psalm, in verse number 18, it says this, "Thou hast ascended on high. Thou hast led captivity captive. Thou hast received gifts for men, yea, for the rebellious also, that the Lord God might dwell among them." Ephesians chapter number 4, verses 7 through 8 says, "But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men." The Apostle Paul says, "Why do you strut around and boast and brag as if you're something and you've accomplished something?" When he says that everything you have, you've been given of the Lord. Amen. What do you have that God did not give you? Amen. The gift of God. The gifts of God come many fashions, many ways, many types, different times. The gift of God. The Lord Jesus Christ ascended to the right hand of the Father and gave gifts to men. This was prophesied in the book of Psalm, chapter number 68. And the prophecy, of course, was fulfilled when the Lord Jesus Christ approached the Father. Approaching the Father, therefore, was one of the most critical times in all of history. For when he approached the Father, the God-man who was born on this earth 2,000 years ago, came into the presence of holiness and a righteous God. Would he dare approach God on his own holiness and his own righteousness? For he could be rejected. But God cannot reject perfection. And he cannot reject pure holiness. And he cannot reject pure righteousness. So a man that did not leave heaven but now is approaching heaven. A man is coming into the very presence of God. A man, the God-man. And God received him. In John chapter number 6 and verse 62, the Word of God said, "And what? And if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before." The Lord Jesus was fond of that term. He referred to himself time and again as the Son of Man. The Lord Jesus Christ, forever the Son of God, second person of the Trinity. "Can I not call 12 legions of angels? Have not I power? Can he not walk on the water? Can he not raise the dead? Can he not heal the sick?" Of course he can. He's the second person of the Trinity, never ceased to be that. Never ceased to be that. But the Scripture says in Philippians 2 that he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. "Wherefore God hath highly exalted him." So we know the Bible teaches us that the Lord Jesus Christ, when he came to this world, said, "What, and if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before?" How are you going to handle that? What are you going to do with that? How are you going to handle it? When a saint dies, when an individual who's a born-again believer leaves this world, there is no visible representation of that because a spirit is an invisible being. And that's what you are. You're a spirit. Possessing a soul, living in a body. You're a spirit being that leaves this world. They're leaving right now. Every moment, there's a spirit being passing from this earth into the presence of God. The Apostle Paul says that we know that if the earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. That house not made with hands and that building that is made by the hand of God is your abode until He comes with you, 1 Corinthians 15, to raise a glorified body to meet Him in the clouds and in the air. When body, soul, and spirit come together, something takes place that took place at His ascension. Look what it said in John 20, verse 17. Jesus saith unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. God was the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ in a unique way. He was not the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ like He's the God and Father of you. Not the same. He's the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ because He begat the Son 2,000 years ago when the God-man was born in Bethlehem of Judea. He's your Father when you were begotten by the Holy Spirit, born again, whenever that date was, during your temporal life on this earth. He became your Father. Until that moment, your father was the devil, John 8:44. That's what He said to the Pharisees. You are of your father, the devil. So the brotherhood of man and the fatherhood of God won't fit in the Bible. It may fit in pop theology, but it won't fit the Bible. There's something about us that is far, far, far different than this world. Far different, far different. And the difference runs very deep. It runs to our very nature and essence. A profound change took place when you were born again. The problem is that an unsaved man can't see that, because you can't see a spirit. But what we have with each other, born-again believers, is the witness of the Spirit. If you have the Holy Spirit in you, the Holy Spirit in you witnesses with the Holy Spirit in another believer. We have the witness of the Spirit. Therefore, we know, brethren, we know sisters in the Lord. We know them. We have this knowledge. It's a unique thing. It's something that's different. The world doesn't have that knowledge. You have to prove to them. And then even as you prove to them, the only thing you're proving to them is that you're sincere. Because there's no way they can understand the new birth. Not until they've experienced it. You can't put it on a piece of paper. So He said in the book of John, chapter number 20, I've not yet ascended. So the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ was a big deal. The resurrection of Christ was a big deal. If He hadn't risen from the dead, all of His words would have been in vain. By rising from the dead, He was declared to be the Son of God. By the resurrection from the dead. But His ascension is a different thing. His ascension is not just something that took place so the disciples could see Him leave the Mount of Olives. It wasn't just some religious event that took place in time so they could record it in the Bible. The ascension of Christ is a big deal because the ascension of Christ comes in three stages. The stage as He left the earth. The stage as He traversed through the kingdom of hell, the principalities and powers that are above us. And then the third stage as He entered into the very presence of God Himself. The ascension of Christ. He ascended. Why did He ascend? The Bible says in the book of Acts, chapter number 1 and verse 3, to whom also He showed Himself alive after His passion by many infallible proofs. I like words like that. They're absolute and complete. There's no question about infallibility. You see, there's only one infallible thing, by the way, and that's the Bible. There is no infallible man on this earth. Forget that junk. So your church taught you that, they taught you wrong. The book is infallible. To whom He showed Himself alive after His passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. The number 40 is very significant in the Bible, because the number 40 is a time of testing and trial. So it must have been a time of trial. If you'll remember, He spent 40 days in the wilderness tempted of the devil. 40 years they wandered in the wilderness, the Old Testament saints. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights on this earth. 40, therefore, shows up as a time of trial and testing in the presence of God because God's the one who gives the testing and the trial. So for 40 days, He was here on this earth being witnessed visually by believers. And the fact of the matter is, only believers saw Him after His resurrection. Unbelievers could have. But the record of Scripture is that only believers saw Him. Why is that? Why is it that He kept it from the view of unbelievers? Why would He do such a thing like that? You suppose He has a reason for that? Do you suppose that the resurrected body of the Lord Jesus Christ now had come into a state of being that was altogether like our state of being will be when body, soul, and spirit is perfected and united together? Think about that for a moment. At the end of 40 days, the earth could no longer hold him. He was no longer of the earth. After 40 days, he ascended from the earth. The earth had no clutches on him. The earth had no claim to him. Those that dwell upon the earth, for the Bible says those that dwell upon the earth in the book of Revelation, it distinguishes those who dwell upon the earth, earth dwellers. A dweller is one who remains there, who lives there, whose roots are there, whose heart is there, whose soul is there, whose life is there. And the Lord Jesus Christ had no connection with them. He had no connection. He's not an earth dweller. Though his body came from this earth, for his body came out of the virgin's womb. And the God-man was born 2,000 years ago. And the God-man came into this world. The God-man, the Son of God, came down from above. The second person of the Trinity. But a man went back to heaven. The God-man. A man ascended to the right hand of the Father. And the Bible says there is one God. And one mediator between God and men. The man. Christ Jesus. There must be something special about the God-man. As it relates to us. That gives him an identity that bears relationship to us. As the man, Christ Jesus. As the God-man. That puts him in our classification. Or puts us in his classification. Or brings us to a mutual meeting point. Where the two of us can meet together as we could never before. There is no way that I can touch God. There is no way I'll ever be God. I'll never be God. There is no way God would ever be me. He couldn't be me. If God was ever me, he'd be a lost sinner. He'd be born under the curse. But God did become a man. And by becoming a man, he was able to touch men in a way he could never touch them before. By touching men, he became a man. By becoming a man, he set himself in a classification that none before him have ever had. And none since him will ever have, except through him. There is something about the God-man that is altogether mysterious. It's, you can just begin to touch the surface of it and get a grasp of it. But it's a deep thing. It's a very personal thing. The God-man is seated at the right hand of the Father. It is the God-man that will sit upon the throne as the judge of the universe. The God-man is the one that has been given all judgment, has been given to him. Hallelujah to God. So the Bible says for 40 days by many infallible proofs. I'm fallible. What is fallible? Fallible is connected with fallacious. What does that mean? That means that I'm imperfect. That means I'm capable of error. That means that there's a fault attached to me. That means that I come short. That means that I just, as hard as I try, I miss the mark. But when something is infallible, it is above reproach. It can't be touched. It's above the mark. It sets the mark. It is the standard. So the Bible says after his resurrection, for 40 days... Then in Acts chapter number 1 and verse 9, when he had spoken these things while they beheld. The apostle wants you to know that. Luke wants you to understand they were looking. While they beheld, visibly, with a naked eye. While they beheld, he was taken up. And a cloud received him out of their sight. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. This is a visible ascent. He ascends. Now remember, when he came down, no one saw him. When he came into this earth, nobody saw his spirit enter this world. Gabriel said to Mary, he said, you're going to, that holy thing that's in you is the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Spirit impregnated Mary. He put life in her. He put the spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ in the virgin's womb. And he became in that virgin's womb the God-man. And so now what had come into the world invisibly leaves the world visibly. It's a statement being made. There's something going on. In Acts chapter number 1 and verse 12. And then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet. Which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey. The Mount of Olives is attached with olive. The olive tree. The olive fruit. Olive oil. Olive is given for a light. Olive burns and gives off light. Olive soothes the skin. Olive feeds the soul. the olive is mixed with other mixture with certain spices and so forth can create the holy anointing oil. It's something that is very gift. It's a gift of God, a very blessed thing. And so it's fitting that he leaves from the olive, a mountain of olives, Olivet. The Bible said in Luke 24:50, he led them out as far as Bethany. And he lifted up his hands and he blessed them. That blessing continues. Nobody can stop it. Don't ever let the devil tell you he can. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. You're a son of God by the new birth. You have the very essence of God in your soul. If he hath blessed you, you cannot be cursed. He hath blessed us, the Bible says in the book of Ephesians. Blessings that you can't see with the eye, but they're real. He hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's a blessing. That's a blessing. So many people pull out their wallet and say, I've been blessed. Well, that's incidental. That's incidental. Listen, folks, there are so many things that money cannot buy, but the blessing gives them to you. And when you cast your gold and silver into the streets, and that's what they'll do in this world, the Bible says the day will come when they cast their gold and their silver into the streets, it'd be worthless. Imagine something that cost over $1,000 an ounce. Worthless. Worthless. And yet, my friend, if God's blessed you, you've been blessed. You've been blessed. I've been blessed. He hath blessed me. He's blessed me. Can you receive that? You notice the gifts and callings of God are without repentance? A gift is something that must be received. It's been given. Can you receive the gift? In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, he talks about the gifts of the Spirit. In the book of Ephesians, he talks about the gifts of the apostles, the prophets, and the ministers of Christ that's given to the church for the building of the edification of the body of Christ and so forth. All these are gifts. That's a whole new study, different study altogether, what all these gifts are. But he gives these gifts. But all these gifts are directly related to his ascension and exaltation at the right hand of the Father. It's almost as if the Lord Jesus Christ has become the representative man where God is able to do to man what he wanted to do to him before but could never do it. Now he can through Christ. Everybody in the world wants to be free, but you can't give them freedom. A man must be free here. If a man is not free here, you're wasting your time trying to give him. Oh, they scream for freedom. I'm going to be free. No, you're a bound of sin. He that committeth sin is a slave of sin, the Bible says, a servant. So the Lord Jesus becoming the representative man, God is able to do for him what he could never do for the first Adam. He's able to give him gifts because he can receive them. There is nothing the Father can give that the Son cannot receive. You see? And he did not give him the Holy Ghost by measure, remember? But he does us. Why? Well, we can't receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Probably because we wouldn't last 5 minutes if we did. I mean, if you were really filled with the Holy Ghost, the way the Lord Jesus was filled with the Holy Ghost, you'd be leaving here. See you later, alligator. Finished. History. My work's done. God's calling me home. You know why? Because your soul would be so full of heaven and with the power of eternity and the glory of God and the presence of the Eternal One. You'd be so full of that world that this world would be nothing but a dark speck in front of you. If you had the fullness of the Holy Ghost like he had the fullness of the Holy Spirit, you couldn't make it here. A man couldn't handle that. But God is able through his Son to give to us what we could never receive any other way. And then the Lord Jesus Christ, in turn, gives to us as he meets it out to us. He's the giver, gave gifts to men. How many have you a handout tonight? Not for filthy lucre, but for something real. The first gift he gave me in 1973, life. Boy, I took hold of it. I grasped it. I embraced it. I pulled life into my soul. Because I was dead, been dead all my life. Didn't know it, but he gave me life. And I said, man, I got something here. Boy, what a gift. The gift of life. That's something. That's the beginning of the gifts. If he can give you life, my goodness, what else can he give you? So the Bible said in Psalm chapter number 68, verse 18, thou hast ascended on high. Thou hast led captivity captive. Thou hast received gifts for men, yea, for the rebellious also. What about that group? The Bible said, denying the Lord that bought them. It's as if he is saying, I have all of this available for every human being on the face of the earth. Every good and perfect gift cometh down from the Father of lights, in whom is no variableness, no shadow of turning, comes through Christ, but available for all men, but all men won't receive it. Did he not die on the cross for all? Did he taste death for every man? He certainly did. He bore my sin, your sin. He said, John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away sins of the world, sin of the world. Which one is it? Which one? Sin. In other words, that block, that wall, that separation, he removes it between God and man. He took it away. So even for the rebellious. But notice what he said. Wherefore he saith in Ephesians 4, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive. He leads because he's the captain of our salvation. Greek word is archegon. He's the one who goes before, is a pioneer, who charts the way. The scripture says, he ascended on high, led captivity captive, gave gifts to men. Now that he ascended, what is it but first he also descended, first into the lower parts of the earth. I saw a thing a couple of days ago. How many of you have been told the center of the earth is a molten mass? I was, and we've all been told that. You've all been told that. It's something, you know, something's in the core of the earth. But problem is, ain't nobody ever been down there. The Bible says that the heart of the earth has a heart. It has a center. The earth could have a place in the center of the earth. That right now you call hell, or a place called paradise on the other side of it. There could be a place down there in the center of the earth. How big is it? I don't know how big it is. But I'm not going to let a geologist preach theology to me. Okay? I'm not going to do it. If the Bible says the earth has a heart, you say, well, now that's symbolic, preacher. Well, you understand the heart's the center. It's the essence. It's the soul. The earth has a soul in that sense. I'm not saying the earth's a living being. I'm not a tree hugger. That's not what I'm saying. Don't believe in Mother Earth. That's Diana and the rest of them. But the earth has a heart. It has a heart. In other words, it has a center. It has a center mass. It has a place. The Bible said he descended first in the lower parts of the earth. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure, the stature, the fullness of Christ. This is Paul talking. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase the body to the edifying of itself in love. Man, that's a powerful statement the apostle makes here. That's in Ephesians chapter number 4, verses 11 through 16. Turn to Isaiah 14. Isaiah chapter number 14. Verse number 12. Isaiah 14, verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O light bearer? That's what Lucifer means. Light bearer. O Lucifer. Son of the morning. New Bibles call him the bright and morning star, confounding him with Christ, or they call him the morning star. Son of the morning, how art thou cut down to the ground which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend. Well, that's what Christ did. He ascended. Lucifer said, I will ascend. Well, Christ did ascend. What's the difference? Did he want something good? Was that a good aspiration on his part? Or was there a motive behind it? Was there an underlying motive? You see? In Philippians 2, he said, he first descended. In other words, he took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. See? He came down. He came down in complete trust and obedience unto the Father. He said, I came not to say the words that I say, but the words the Father giveth me I say. He said, I came not to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. I can only say what he tells me to say. I can only do what he tells me to do. In plain words, he came in complete obedience to the Father. He yielded himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He got full measure and understanding of the death of the cross at Gethsemane when it began to flood his soul as to what faced him. And then at the cross, it hit him. And when it hit him, he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Here is one who had cast himself upon the Father, who had trusted the Father, who had yielded to the Father, who had died for the Father. What would the Father do with one like that? God's integrity now is at stake. What will you do, Father, with one who died like that for you? When you put God to the test, he will always pass it. He will never fail his test. He said, try me. Prove me. Try him. The reason you don't try him, the reason I don't try him, and the reason Satan didn't try him is because we have a wicked ulterior motive, sometimes even covered up by our own righteousness, where we're not even able to really see what's inside the heart and in the soul. But here and there, a spark of fire will fire into your soul, and you'll crawl off in a hole somewhere, and you'll lay yourself out before God, and it's live or die, sink or swim, here I am. Nothing between us. I'll lay it all out before you. That's trying him. He delights in that. Then he gets to talk to the real man. So Satan, what are you doing here in Isaiah 14? I will ascend. I know how to do it. I know what it takes. So he attempted. What happened to him? He said, thou shalt be brought down to hell. And he was. The Lord Jesus said, I saw Satan as lightning fall to the earth. No man saw that, but he did. Cast down to the earth. Lightning, 186,000 miles a second. All of a sudden, Satan has lifted himself up in his glory and his praise and his honor and his beauty. The angelic host standing around in awe at such a beautiful creature. There was none that had his beauty and his wisdom, his power, his ability. He was the very leader of the choir of glory. He was that anointed cherub that covereth. There was none higher except that invisible being that nobody could lay an eye upon. And here he stood before God's creation. He lifted himself up, and all of God's creation was standing before him and thought, my, my, who is this? And in a moment, like a bolt of lightning, he disappeared from before their eyes and was cast down to the earth and lifted himself up in the dust, crawling up a tree like a serpent. That's Lucifer. Still got his wisdom. Still got his power. Still got everything. There's nowhere in the Bible that said he stripped him of his power. It stripped him of his position. Cast him down. Here's the Lord Jesus, comes out of glory with all power and might. An eternal person, the second person of the Godhead. Here he is, the Creator himself. Here's the one the angels look upon when they sing, holy, holy, holy. It's the Son of God they see. No man knows the Father but the Son. No man knows the Son but the Father. If the Son doesn't show you the Father, you'll never see him. And here he is. In his glory, his creatures are before him. And all of a sudden, they see him, the Creator, bow himself, yield himself to a will, an invisible being, and come down and incarnate himself in flesh, and for 33 years walk this dirty road and bleed and die. Those angels marveled at it. The Bible says they did. It says these angels looked at him and they marveled at what was going on. They marveled. They marveled. Then when he went to the tree and he died, laid in a virgin tomb. And on the third day when the sun rose and the stone was rolled away, out of that grave came a man with glory like no man had ever had. And these angels laid their eyes upon this God-man. It was Christ, but it was Christ as a man. It was the one they worshipped in heaven. It was the second person of the Trinity. They recognized him, yet he was a man now. And here for 40 days walked on this earth and then ascended. The earth couldn't hold him anymore. Do you know why they couldn't hold him? Because he was no longer this earth. When he arose from the dead, he walked the earth as the second man. When he arose from the dead, he rose as the last Adam. When he comes in glory and shouts the names of the saints of God, soul and spirit come in the heavens, and the voice goes in deep into the graves. The hour is coming when all that are in the graves shall hear the voice of the Son of God and come forth. That voice will penetrate down to the soul. And when it does, all of a sudden a body comes rising up out of that grave, a glorified body, a body he talked about in 1 Corinthians 15. First it's terrestrial, now it's celestial. First it's without honor, now it is with honor. First it is weak, and now it is strong. It comes out of the ground. And when soul and spirit and body are united, you're perfected. And the moment you're perfected, the earth loses its power. And you ascend. It's done. Amen. That's what it's about. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I'll finish with this. While they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. Wonder who they were. Which also said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? The same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you've seen him go into heaven." Then returned they to Jerusalem, the Mount of Olives, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. In like manner? Yeah. Okay, liberal. Hear the word of God. He doesn't come in spirit, inspiring men to live good lives. He comes in power and glory in a physical body to catch his saint up. And catch us up to meet him in the clouds and rule over this earth with a rod of iron. The liberal would have you believe that it's only his spirit that comes back in the sense of Shakespeare that inspires men. No, my friend. It is the personal return of the Lord Jesus Christ. As he went, so will he come. So we look. It's called that blessed hope of the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. We look for his appearing. We've been looking a long time. We're going to keep looking. Amen. Amen. He's going to come. Father, in Jesus' name, bless your word. Bless the service tonight. Thank you for the sweet Holy Ghost in my soul. Thank you, Holy One. You've been good to me. Lord God, you've been so good to me. Lord, I don't know why. Why? But I bless you tonight. I bless your sweet name. Glorify thy holy name. We're in here tonight. We're your body. We love you. We exalt you. We manifest you. God, we lift thee up in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless his holy, holy, holy name, his righteous, righteous, righteous name. That sweet holy name of Jesus. Bless that name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know, Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not the way. We know not whither thou goest. How can we know the way? The Lord Jesus said, I am the way. Just like he said, I am the resurrection. The way and the resurrection is not a thing, it is a person. I better shut up. I'll start in again tonight. Hallelujah.